some of the greatest help and openings that I've experienced in my own Dharma life have been about the surrender side, in a sense. Because, you know, speaking culturally, you know, we always hear in the West, we're very sort of effortful and mental and full of striving. And the Hinayana and Mahayana paths, as you've been talking about them, are very, it's like, you know, working up a sweat, examining, looking, and I've certainly done some of that. Mm-hmm. But where is this surrender piece? Where is this trusting one's own Buddha nature piece? Where is the trusting the flow? Like sometimes in certain communities, they say trust the Dharma, and what they mean is the flow of how things will unfold toward you, mm-hmm. or toward us all, or toward the whole situation. And can you speak a little bit about the play of effort and surrender? And if it is a question of resultant vehicle, you know, if that's kind of the others pulling from the other side in a sense, then that's okay. But if you could clarify that for me a little bit.
Not necessary to divide it between causal and resultant vehicle at all. Two times in your life as a meditator, you come closest to doing it the easy way. One is compassion, and the other is devotion. Two things, very simple things. But both of those things, we begin to exercise, our ego mind begins to exercise its wisdom. So ignorance is very clever. Ignorance loves to articulate and express and be intelligent. And we hunger, and we always have this essence. The bad habit that we have is we think unless it's very difficult, it shouldn't be appreciated. So this whole sweating it out and doing it, the effort part of it, becomes that which feeds into the ego's pretense of being wise. So compassion, kindness, selfless kindness, how simple can that be? And yet we begin to find volumes and volumes of books to read in order to understand how to be selflessly kind. We then have all these number of questions and hesitations and doubts and struggles, and we think to be selflessly kind has to be a lot of hard work. Without it becoming very complicated, how am I ever going to say that I found something that is unique? And so our own ego and the ignorant mind begins to act up in such a way that it feeds on into the complications and makes a huge U-turn. And instead of coming right to the point, taking that huge detour, goes the scenic route, and then comes back to the same point. Devotion and surrenderance is also the same in Vajrayana, for example. If you surrender to the absolute true nature, how simple can that be? It simply asks for you to not be so clever, isn't it? And that immediately becomes an affront for the ego, and we think, wow, this is somebody telling me not to be clever. That means, am I going to be stupid? Am I going to be ignorant? I'm not going to be able to know. How am I going to ever then come out and say, well, I am wise? And so, for example, you can just ask yourself the question, what do you really think is primordial wisdom? Often it seems to be in our mind where we think primordial wisdom is someone who knows enough information that only 10 elephants can carry. Isn't it? That's what our assumption is of what wisdom is. It never occurs to us that wisdom may mean just being quiet. And so where the ego feeds into a kind of an expectation that it has to articulate, express, know many things, do many things, and so many things, and only can then you really appreciate, then such a mind will not accept the simplicity of enlightenment as being just kind or just being devoted. And then we fall into the complications of the race. And so there's the whole point of one of the things is the more learned you are in Buddha Dharma, one is that you're very wise and clever and learned. And the other aspect is that you're becoming more and more distant from what is very simple. So when we say refuge and then we learn Mahayana, means refuge failed. You didn't get the point. You missed it. And then you came up there. Now you start Wondro practices, isn't it? You failed there somewhere in the beginning. And now you're doing Wondro. That fails, you go to Yidam practice. That fails, you go to Trekta. That fails, you go to Thogal. That fails, you go to Mahar Mudra. That fails, you go to Dzogchen, and then you die. That's how it is. But in that way, jokes apart, if you look carefully, enlightenment and that which is the absolute true nature, the simple nature, intrinsic of oneself, remaining within there, shouldn't have to depend upon all these number of things that we do. But it doesn't satisfy our ego at all. We always think it's so hard to get the simplest thing done. Therefore, how can such a thing as enlightenment not involve hard work? And so if anyone taught, and the Buddha did teach in the beginning the simplest form of what enlightened mind is, be true to your intrinsic nature, remain there. But that doesn't sound appetizing. There is no sweating it out. There is no learning to do. There is no accomplishments to do. There is no grades and levels to go through. There are no compositions to make, isn't it? And so we think, oh, it has to be complicated. It has to be difficult. And we love suffering. And we love to suffer and get things done in a complicated way and have this resistance and arguments and debates and so on and so forth. Ultimately, what do you think we'll all come up to is that none of those things were ever necessary. It was from here to here, and we missed the point, and we went from here to there, to there, to this way, to that way, to this way, and that way, instead of just being here in this moment. And so we say simple things like, to be silent and still in this moment, our true nature, to be one within our own true nature. But how do we do that? Oh, there you, how you do that is, once upon a time, there was a Shakyamuni Buddha who then went into this thing, and then the third, and so forth, and so on, and so forth. And then we ask, how? And then how is in so many classifications and so many different things. Who said that? Oh, this was said by Padmasambhava, and so on and so forth. How can we believe this is true? Because if you investigate in this way, and then this way, and this way, and this way, and this way. That's how 84,000 tenets evolved, to find emptiness. Isn't it? So surrenderance and being able to really work, as you said, with the resultant path, or this is what usually Dzogchen teachings, Mahamudra teachings and Dzogchen teachings teach about, is the courage that really is required of a meditator is to be able to understand and appreciate the vastness, the profoundness of simplicity. Surrenderance is being able to not pretend to be something that you don't need to be. And it's the greatest attack on the ego. And therefore, it's always the most difficult thing to do also.